my gaffer came to me and said, he's like, I think we have 47 lights playing right now or something crazy. And the crazy part is they chose this location before I got up to scout, okay. Which is, I recommend if you are a producer listening to this, don't ever do that. Because I get there and I'm like, how am I supposed to light this? Oddly enough, the idea was conceived of pre-pandemic, and it's kind of a pandemic movie, which is weird, yeah. And super creepy. And I knew in my gut that it wasn't a good idea.
Yeah.
Getting into that canoe, I was like, oh, I don't know about this, man. And sure enough, at some point, the canoe tipped over and we lost a f-ing camera. Because it was such a dramatic thing to happen, it kind of bonded our crew because we were kind of like, holy f-, I can't believe that happened.
Hey everyone, welcome to the second episode of The Moving Image. We are making it happen, we are getting the ball rolling, and I am doing my best to seem calm and collected while I'm in front of the camera, even though I am a ball of nerves on the inside. I'm trying my best not to show you that. So bear with me and thank you for sticking with us. Today we have a great guest. His name is Rob Scarborough, CSC. You may have seen some of his work on the Baroness Von Sketch Show, films like Room for Rent. And today we're breaking down his show, his latest show, The Lake, that's on Amazon Prime. He just finished shooting season 2, so that's going to be really interesting. And we are also talking about his latest feature film. It's a project called Ashgrove, directed by Jeremy Lalonde. And this is really interesting because it's a very different approach to filmmaking. It was all shot in 10 days, which is crazy to me. And that's not even the craziest part. The movie doesn't have a script. Yeah, I know, that's crazy. I mean, it does have an outline. There is a story to it. You know, there's obviously there's direction. It's a very well thought out process, but it relies heavily in improvisation. And it was a very creative process all around from all sides, from everyone involved. It was a very slim crew, very slim cast as well, featuring Amanda Bruegel and Jonas Chernik, who are also producers of the movie. So that is it's a great cast. But yeah, I just want to talk about that, the approach of cinematography to improvised scenes. When you don't really know what's going to happen in front of the camera and you have to make it look beautiful and you have to capture that emotion, right? So you have to be very attentive of what's going on. I'm going to let Rob explain that. So join me in this interview, in this breakdown. And without further ado, Rob Scarborough, CSC. All right, so here we are in studio with Rob Scarborough, CSC. Thanks for being here, man.
Yeah, of course. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no worries. All right, so I guess I'll just jump straight into it. I'd love to hear what your path was from the moment you decided to go into film,
yeah,
to the moment you finally said, okay, I am a director of photography.
Right.
Like officially.
Yeah, it's a longer story. I'll try to keep it concise. But the real trajectory was, like, I started making skate videos with my friends. I still skateboard now, but not as intensely as I did then. But and I always carried a camera around, like just a stills camera, which eventually evolved into like a Hi8 camera that was usually from the school. There was a course in my high school. It's kind of like an arts high school sort of. It had arts class, like really great arts classes, and it was called communications. And so we were able to make movies, and I was just the one that I would be the one there late at night and on weekends if I had to, and. And I didn't actually know that was a career path. I was just like doing it. And so my friend has a brother that went to film school. And I found out in high school that he was going to film school. And I was like, film school? There's a school for movie making? Like, that's crazy. I didn't even know there was a job. And so I talked to him about it and just realized that if I can, my first thought was if I can make a living doing what I'm doing at school that I like doing, making movies with my friends. That was my first life. I can make movies with my friends and make money. That's like the best job in the world. I can't imagine there's a better job than that. And so I went to school, and everyone thinks they want to be a director when they go to film school. So I went to Humber College, and the first day of film school, you know, the professor always asks, who wants to be a director? And every single person puts up their hand. And by the end of that 3 years, there's like 3 people or something, right?
Yeah.
Which is good. Which is like what film schools should do.
It should find your path.
Yeah, find your path, exactly. And so I was directing for all 3 years when I was there, but I realized my favorite stuff was collaborating with like writers and directors more. And I didn't really, again, I didn't really realize that cinematography was a job. So, you know, so we were shooting on film. We were shooting some of the first couple projects were on like digital, like HD cameras, but there was a couple projects on film, which were the ones that I kind of realized I was better than some people in my classes at that specific, because I had a background in just framing things with a stills camera or shooting, you know, skits with my friends for the skate videos. And I just realized I was kind of good at that. And I also like had more, I got more satisfaction out of seeing the final product that I helped create rather than me creating this entire thing. And then maybe it doesn't turn out very well because it's film school and everything kind of sucks. And so like, I've just got more satisfaction knowing that I could, you know, have this, this part of this thing that's just me. And then I don't have to worry about really the final product. I just know that it looks nice. And I was more satisfied just the way that how I added to that project rather than a director who's responsible for if everything, like the sound and the titles. And so I found that out sort of shooting my friends' projects, that's just what I've lean to, just purely based on I just found more satisfaction out of it. Like directing, I found it very hard to collaborate in that environment. It's hard because everyone's figuring out what they want to do, and so no one's really great at anything. So you're trying to make something good and not be an asshole and not, you know, and try to not you know, come down too hard on people, but maybe my standards were a little higher. And I always found it hard to have those conversations of like, it's just not good enough. We need to fix this.
Yeah.
And I hated having those conversations. I just hated it. So I, at all cost, I would avoid those conversations. And one of the ways was to just be the DP and not have to have those conversations.
Yeah, and I guess it was easier and more satisfactory to have those images in your reel than to actually have that finished project that wasn't very good in like a whole
As a whole. Yeah, and some things turned out great, and you know, like some things were actually still, like I still look back at some of that stuff and it's pretty inventive, like the ideas are there and stuff, just the execution, our technical abilities weren't to up to par yet, you know, up to standard.
Yeah, and then after school, how did it look?
Oh yeah, right, there's only half of the story. so the next part was, I started working as a PA right after school, which I got really, really lucky. My friend of mine was working in music videos, and he told a producer friend that, or just a guy he knew, hey, I have this roommate. He also went to film school. He can help us out on this music video. It's like, you know, low budget thing. And so I started off as a PA in music videos, and some of the music videos were very big. It was like with Director X did a bunch of them when I was there, and he was coming up. He was just starting out then, so I just got to be a PA and watch that whole process of big videos and tiny no budget videos. But what I realized is that as soon as you step on set in a real situation, I'm like, I didn't learn anything in film school. You know, I just didn't. You realize that pretty quickly. You're like, holy shit, I didn't know what that cable did or where to plug the cable in or what. Yeah. You know. Or just like the basic structure of a set, like the ADs etiquette. And the etiquette of a set, like that stuff. Hopefully they teach that now, but I didn't get taught any of that stuff. So I learned as a PA, just being able to sit back and watch people work, all of those the etiquette of a set and being able to work in every department, as in commercials and in music videos. It's very collaborative, like they want the PAs to help every department. You're kind of there, and you're there to help them because they're low staffed because it's a music video. Yeah. And so, I'm working in the art department, I'm working in the camera department, on and off, and I got to know a bunch of people. And then that sort of led me to electricing. And so I wanted to shoot everybody that I was working with, all the like the older guys that were that I was PAing with, and I was still. I was still in the meantime from school on, I was always shooting my own stuff. So I found, you know, scripts and found friends that were directors, and just shot everything I could. So while I was PAing, I was just shooting stuff and you know, not a lot of it didn't see the light of day. But during that time, at least I built this little tiny reel of stuff from school. And in that three year period in which I was like sort of PAing and then transitioning into electricing, I still built this reel in that 3 year period, in which then at the end of that 3 years, I was like, I'm not going to do either of those. I'm just going to start shooting. Maybe about 4 years total after I stopped electricing. So I brought this, I used to bring a DVD of my reel that I had made in those, and so basically from 2001 into 2005, maybe four. And I just, and there was a director, a guy named Chris Grismer, who was like, I owe a lot of my, him and his partner at the time gave me a lot of my first jobs, the first people to give me a camera and hand me, and get me into documentary filmmaking. But Chris was directing big budget, like, or not big budget, but medium budget stuff with Feist and Metric and all kind of bands like that. And so he gave me, so at some point he found out that I wanted to shoot stuff. He's like, oh, I heard you want a DP. And he was just the nicest dude in the world. So I was like, yeah, I actually got a reel in my bag. as a 40-year-old guy now, I feel like I wouldn't do that now. Like, I'd be like, that was ballsy of me. Just be like, hey, director, you know, here's the... But again, if you meet... I just felt like the right... Timing's everything, and it felt like the right time to do that. Because I knew him well enough. Yeah, exactly. And so I handed him this DVD, and he's like, hey, why don't we just... I'll watch it. Why don't you bring it over, and we'll have dinner some night, and we'll watch it together. And I'm like, oh, that sounds awesome. So I went over there and literally put it on for him, and we watched it, and... You know, he gave me some feedback, and then the next time I saw him, he just handed me a camera on one of his music videos and was like, just go shoot stuff. I was like, awesome. And so his partner at the time was a producer. She was producing videos and commercials. Sarah Gibson is her name. Also, I owe a lot to her because she introduced me to a guy named Henry Less, who also I owe a lot to. Those three people really are like the start of my career.
Yeah.
So Henry Less is a director, DP. And he was doing a ton of documentary stuff at the time. Documentary and sort of when reality TV met documentary, but he was also doing true documentary stuff at the time too. And so Sarah, Chris, the director's partner, was producing for Henry. And again, noticed that, and she was, you know, at the dinner, you know, at this guy's house, and she noticed, and she's like, oh, I have this show. We're traveling to this and we need a camera operator. So luckily I just literally got on a show probably shouldn't have got that job, but I got along with her so well. And Henry Less is a really great teacher, to young, filmmakers, that he was all for it. You know, he saw the reel and he saw the potential maybe. And then he hired me to do this, these documentaries, and sort of when it bordered on reality stuff, like, for Food Network, we did a bunch of food shows. We did a lot of traveling together. So I started electricing, and then that led to me giving a director a reel, and that led to that person introduced me to someone else. And eventually, when I became a camera operator in documentary world, I just stopped PAing and stopped electricing, and then just did a lot of docu stuff for a long time. And that led into like when the reality TV boom hit. I started doing that, but then I realized I really didn't want to do that. So I stopped it pretty quick. But at least, like, again, I get all those things that you, looking back at it, I did learn a lot of stuff from each step of the way.
Yeah.
You know, like those reality shows, they're tough to shoot. Like, they're not tough in a way that's like, you're actually shooting paint dry. That's literally what you're doing. So I started shooting documentaries, and I traveled all over the world shooting documentaries, and then in the meantime, just finding my friends from school that wanted to make movies, we would shoot short films together, and I would shoot the short films, and then eventually I did three features in a row in 2006 that were, I helped produce one, I shot two of them. All low, super low budget, like under $50,000 for each one.
And you were the DP for those?
For two of the three. So okay. I produced one of them. I was like the, you know, grip gaffer, assistant editor. And then the other two, so I had built this reel based on all the stuff that I was just doing for free, essentially. That then led to, again, just like the opportunities. So I think the best thing for me that I took from that was like, I just shot anything and everything. And even though you think at the time that it might not be the best choice, you will learn something from it. If not like a piece of gear, you might meet someone interesting. You might travel somewhere interesting. There's always something to take from every job.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, like as you get into the industry, ego takes over sometimes, right? Like, you're like, I don't want to do that shit. Now, especially now, I'm like, I'll do that shit. I'll do whatever. But at least at the time, most of the project I was getting were things I wanted to do until the documentary TV world started to evolve into reality TV stuff. And I was like, okay, I'm out. Just not to offend anyone that works in that world. It didn't hit me creatively in any way.
Yeah, it's not for you.
It's not for me. So then I just basically at that point, I just became, I just said I was a DP and probably not rightfully so, but I faked it till I made it.
Yeah.
For a little while.
That's awesome, man.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's awesome. So you would say, that Henry was some sort of mentor for you.
Oh yeah. 100%. Henry Less. Yeah, for sure. And a lot of directors I worked with and, we're just all very open. Some DPs, I worked for, you know, Adam Marsden as an electric and Sammy Anaya and Simon Showit a little bit. He was just sort of coming up. And Brendan Stacey, really, watching Brendan Stacey work was incredible. Like, you know, he's one of my favorite DPs in the city. And I got to just sit by the monitor sometimes and chat with him about what he's doing. And, you know, at some point I was probably even suggesting things and he'd just laugh and then... I think at one point he's like, that's a good idea. I think I remember that being like such a satisfactory moment.
That's awesome.
I can remember this. It was like a night shoot and there's a car. And I was like, yeah, they can't really see the grill. She put some light on that grill. He's like, yeah, no. And then he's like, yeah, all right, I should put some light on that grill.
That's awesome.
But it's cool to watch people work. That's the thing I miss about, like, as an electric, get to see people do stuff.
Yeah. That's cool. Like, coming up from the lighting side of it, you get to understand how that gear works and like how light actually
totally
works. That's really cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Big time.
So when you jump into a project, I want to talk about like your work style in that sense. Do you normally have like a go-to crew or do you like working with new people?
Yeah. Like, it took a while to find the crew that I love, for creative reasons, for personality reasons. So I do like to work with the same people as much as I can. Everyone's busy, and it's not always possible to work with everyone that you want. But when you find people that have similar sensibilities and good attitudes and that want to add to the creative process, you kind of hang on to those people because they're very kind of few and far between, is what I've kind of realized. Just as far as like ultimately connecting with someone, you know, like utterly connecting with their taste in movies, their taste in, you know, just tone and style, photography. Like, again, I haven't met a lot of people in my lifetime that have like similar sensibilities. So when I do find those people, whether that be a gaffer or a director or a writer even, I try to hold on as much as I can because it's kind of rare, you know? Yeah. So I tend to hire the same people when I can and when they're available. Yeah.
That's cool. And that goes for like your camera crew and like your lighting and grip.
100%. Yeah. And thankfully I have like a bunch of, I've met so many people over the years that I have a lot of great camera assistants that I know now. So if one's not available, I can go to the next one. And it's now there's no order. It's just like, it's because it used to be like, here's my favorite, here's my second favorite. Yeah. Now it's like, I have like seven great people. Yeah, they're all my favorites. In all honesty, it's almost like when they see me working with someone else, I hope they don't get jealous because it has nothing to do with them whatsoever.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, it's you know, it's business.
It's yeah, like, it's yeah, exactly. And
it's cool.
And sometimes it's, I like to pay back when I do long format stuff. It's a grueling job and it's a lot of work and a lot of hours. So when I get a nice cushy commercial, I want to pay those people back. So the people that I'm now working with on these, I'm doing a couple of commercials next week, are the people that I worked with on my TV show. Most people anyways, that were available. So that I just like that. Here's a nice cushy job for you. So it's, you know, you're not going to be up all night long and working on weekends. You just get to come, we work for 10 hours and we leave and it's going to be great.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So it's nice to be able to pay people back for their hard work.
That's cool. That's awesome.
I mean, they're getting paid for the shows.
Yeah,
obviously,
and especially too, like at commercials, I get for a 10-hour date, it's better money with that.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you're selling something, so it should be better money, right?
Yeah.
That's how I look at it. It's like, you're kind of, well, we're selling your product. No one really, it's a great, I always look at it as a great day job commercial work because even though there are times I get to play with more toys in commercial world, I get to, you know, have more time, sort of, depending on the shoot. But I get to, everyone I've, directors I've met in commercial world, gaffers, like everyone in that world, I love to death, and I'll bring on projects if they want to come with me. So that's kind of the best part about it. It's like this almost like every time I go to do a commercial now, it's like a reunion of all my favorite people in the world, you know.
That's awesome.
And it's awesome. Yeah.
Yeah. And when you land a job like that, is there like any specific gear list that you veer towards, like camera package?
It always depends on the job, you know, like if it's like a day or night thing, or if it's like, you know, if in comedy world, there's always, sometimes it's supposed to look bad on purpose. It's sometimes, so that might be a specific set of lenses, that might be a specific body type, or a zoom lens, which I don't tend to use zoom lenses often, but in comedy, they're kind of very useful. Yeah. In just like reframing during a scene, if you just, because it's a lot more organic, or even, I love a slow zoom though. I just love them. I love them to death. Like very Altman or David Gordon Green does them really well. I love that stuff, but yeah, it just depends on the job, I think.
For sure.
You know, depends on what the story we're telling. Yeah. But I can shed out. I mean, I only use Airy cameras though. just so you know, Airy.
Yeah.
Then give me t-shirts.
No,
I'll take
no
a t-shirt.
So when you're working, what's your process for like lighting and framing and all that stuff? Do you like keeping it simple or do you go all out?
Again, it depends on the job. I think for me, like for example, like Jeremy's movie, Jeremy Lalonde's movie Ashgrove, I used maybe three lights and maybe only one at a time. Three small lights, like nothing, no generator was needed. That you plug them into house power.
Oh wow.
So in that situation, we wanted to make something that's very minimal. We wanted to move fast. We wanted to go room to room. We wanted to have, you know, it under a very controlled scenario where we can stop a scene and go to a different room and shoot something else if we had to, or if something happened in the scene, we were like, oh, now we need to shoot a scene over there. Let's go do that right now. So I had to be fast. And my challenge to myself for this specific movie was to light very minimally, maybe something soft pushing through a window, or just stage the whole thing near a window when it's nice light out there.
Yeah.
So for gear, it's definitely depending on the situation. But the show I did, the Lake, is a bigger show. It has a lot of characters, it has sets, it has big locations. Yeah. So there's just a lot more gear needed. And it's a premium cable show. Premium streaming show.
Yeah. Amazon.
So it's got to look big, right? It's got to look big and fancy and shiny and beautiful. So that just takes more precision. Lighting essentially, yeah. Which means either sometimes bigger, but not always bigger, but just more lighting, right? To make those images look shiny and glossy and, you know, like premium streaming.
For
know?
Sure. Yeah. I guess that's a great segue to just maybe screen some stuff and like try to break it down and see what happened on those shows.
Yeah. Yeah. I talk a lot.
It's ramble. Great. It makes my job easier. So let's talk about the Lake.
Yeah, sure.
Essentially, how did you land the job?
I have an agent, and the agent's very proactive in the community, in the dramatic scripted world. Their Vanguard Artists Management is my agent, and they're the best. It was like a cold call. Like they just called basically Vanguard and said, "We need these key crew. Who do you have, and who can we interview with?" And so they gave a small list of like three or four people or something, and like in production design and whatever they needed. I'm not sure who exactly. I think it was production design and DP, maybe editor, but I think it's just those two. And so it was totally a blind meeting. And every meeting I've done before the Lake was, I always knew someone in the room. Like I interviewed for Kids in the Hall, the new season on Amazon, for that. And I knew Mark, I did a movie with Mark McKinney. So Mark McKinney, I knew him, and I felt comfortable knowing that Mark knows me. And some other things where it's always like, I know the director or I know the producer. I always know somebody
some sort of
in the room.
There.
Yeah, there's some safety in there.
Yeah.
But this one was completely, I went in totally blind. And I just, what I tend to do is make, like a mood board. I call it a lookbook just cause it's a commercial term more so, but like, I've just images of, so I'll read a script and interpret what I feel, the tone of it. And then I go try to find images that give me the same feeling. So I make a book and everyone does this. It's not like,
yeah, visualization.
Yeah. Just so people know what I'm thinking. So I make for the interview, I made a lookbook that just with all these tone images, from movies that I love and character pieces, mostly dramatic character pieces. Mostly it's a comedy, but it's, to me, it was the heart of the story is what grabbed me, like the heart of that, the relationship between the father and daughter. That's, to me, was the show.
Yeah.
So that's what I concentrate on is my visual style. And so I presented that and we looked at it and I described what I was thinking and I had to pitch the director, Paul Fox, who's an executive producer on the show. He suggested widescreen for that. He's like, oh, do you think we could pitch? Because he's a TV director, mm-hmm. and he doesn't get to pitch widescreen often. So he's a film fanatic. He knows films way more than I will ever know. He's just like, he just loves films. So he's like, do you think we could pitch widescreen? And I was like, and I had already made the lookbook of 16:9 images mostly.
Yeah, yeah.
Or at least like a couple widescreens from specific movies. But I was like, oh yeah, I would love to. That'd be great.
And also it's
the lake. Yeah. It's also the lake. There's beautiful scenery that would look great. There's a lot of characters in that show. So it just to pack in that many characters in a 16:9 frame, you're probably gonna have to cut it up into pieces, like this shot, this shot, this shot. Whereas now we can block it with all those people in one shot and stack them in a way that we couldn't with with the spherical lenses.
For sure.
So we pitched this whole thing. Anyways, long story short, I did two interviews with them. I think it was two interviews. I'm pretty sure it was two interviews with the showrunner, Julian Doucette, and the producers at Amaze and some Amazon, the Amazon execs. And I just found out I honestly thought wouldn't get the job. Like I thought it's like a big show. And at that point, I only done like Baroness Von Sketch Show. And I did a bunch of movies and commercials and stuff, but that doesn't really matter in TV. People don't really look at that stuff. I mean, they do a bit more now because premium stuff looks like movies, right?
For sure.
So I think Julian and Paul were the ones that really went to bat for me. I guess I just said something in the interview or something that, so anyway, so, and I'm not sure, and giving credit to Amazon, they didn't blink an eye at the decision. I mean, I'm not sure if they blinked. Maybe they did. But I know Amazon people well now, and they're all really great people, and they supported me the entire way. They were never, there's never questions. Once I got on that set, it was like, it's your thing, do your thing. You pitched us the thing, and we know the thing. Just do the thing.
We like it, so just do it.
Yeah, we like it, just do it, yeah.
Yeah.
So I got it, I got a call, and I was, I was very surprised, to be honest. And it was just felt great. I don't know. It's hard to describe because it was my first big show. So it was just like a nice get over that hump moment, you know?
It's awesome. So I'd love to talk about a couple of the sets that you got there.
Sure.
And maybe an exterior day.
Yeah.
Those are always challenging.
Yeah. There's so many of them. it's like all exterior days. Yeah.
I mean, I'd love to talk about the cabin.
Yeah, totally.
First of all.
So it's beautiful. It's a beautiful set.
Bathroom, kitchen, the living room. Justin sleeps in there, and this is my bedroom.
So this scene is actually not a set. This is a real cabin.
Oh, this is a location?
This is a location that we actually, in season two, is this a spoiler? we built this cabin in studio because it's so small. If you walked into this and we have cameras, anamorphic lenses and the LF at the area, we had one regular LF, which is big and big cameras and the small thing. So, honestly, there's so many great textures in here that does a lot of my job. Like this, I love the way this scene looks, and I love, everything in this cabin looks so good to me. I would always put, you know, a little bit of atmosphere in there so it feels a little bit dirtier.
Yeah.
The production designer, Danielle, she did an awesome job. This actually looks nothing like this in reality. Like, they redid, they literally gutted this person's person's cabin and made it this great. Like, put all those textures on the walls, changed the paint.
Yeah.
And then had to like redo them, I guess, later on.
For sure.
And actually, my big problem was when we walked into this was that the roof was super
slow.
White. Like, well, super low, super low and super white. Like, they had just repainted it or something. And I was like, oh man, it's just gonna bounce everywhere all the time. It's hard to keep that out of the shot because look, as you see, like the ceilings, it's so low you can see it in every single shot.
For sure.
So what Danielle did, I worked with her with just dulling it down with like making it look older and giving it texture so it wouldn't bounce as much light around.
Yeah.
So a big part of this look is me negging wherever I can on that ceiling. There's just right behind the camera, there's things taped to the ceiling, taped to the wall, taped to just negging everywhere I could.
Bring all the duvetine.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
That's
yeah.
awesome.
Yeah, but mostly this is lit from the windows, either 4Ks, 18Ks. It's a crazy location. It's like it's on a bunch of rocks on a hill. So like here's the lake, and it's literally there's like a bunch of rocks, and it's up about 50 feet up here. So there's like a pathway, and then trees everywhere. Trees. This is a tree. So there's a forest all around here. Forest. And the cabin's like right here. There's a patio that kind of wraps around like this.
Mm-hmm.
That's where I'd put lights because it's all rocks everywhere.
Right.
I can't put really light there. I can, it's just really hard. I can't get lifts in there. I can't, it's like, and the crazy part is they chose this location before I got up to scout,
okay.
Which is, I recommend if you're a producer listening to this, don't ever do that because I get there and I'm like, where the fuck am I supposed to put lights? Like, how am I supposed to light this? There's no way to get lights literally anywhere. Like I had to put the light like on the porch. Sometime I could get one in here, but it was like, you know, a chore to get level that properly, point it in the right spot, right, you know. And there's literally just woods all around this. And anyways, so limited the way I did it. So honestly, I look at this and I'm so happy with the way it turned out, but it was a struggle to get exactly, like this is almost like in reaction to the location.
Yeah,
I almost had to light. I was backed into a corner where I had to light it like this. You know, we tried to bounce as much as we could. We tried to soften as much as we could.
For sure.
And they actually the production designer also put great textures on. See all the windows have really great textures. So
yeah.
they're warm. They have
on the
they
shears soften, and
yeah.
all that stuff.
Yeah. So that really helped too.
So you had lights on both sides of the cabin. I guess because
here we
jump the line a little bit.
Yeah,
and then
yeah.
the lighting coming from that window. So you were moving the lights, or you had
exactly
everything rigged up.
Yeah, yeah. So well, we had enough lights that we had just one standing by. So we knew if we were doing this scene, for example, we knew we were going to have to look into that room. So I'd make sure there was like a 4K out here, you know, and then we'd just move around either an 18 or a 4 around that porch coming through those front windows.
Right.
And actually, there's a big bay window here. Actually, we get at 18 through that one because there's a little patch of land right here that it would fit perfectly, but we couldn't really move it left or right. It was like, that's where it goes.
Right.
And if we look out that window, it can't go there. So you have to move it out of the woods.
Yeah.
It's because we're going to look at it. But yeah, but so that it's like anything though, like my job is reacting to stuff all the time. Like all day long, I just react to situations. And this one just happened to be, I get to up north to go scout, and they had already chosen this location. And I was like, oh my God, how am I supposed to deal with this? And even the directors too was like, what are we going to do? And because it's also small inside, not only is it like crazy on the outside, it's like tiny on the inside. So what did, the big pitch for season two was to like, let's build this on set.
Yeah.
And we have full control. And it was amazing. It was so much more. And we move faster because to get a light from, say, you know, that one small patch of land to over here if we needed it is like 25 minutes of time. It's not easy. You can roll it over.
Yeah.
So every move we did was a lot of time there, right?
And I guess the fact that the cabin was really small, I guess played in favor of the anamorphic too, right? Because you could
totally, yeah, 100%.
You could frame stuff up from like back and
struggle
for space
for sure. It actually made the space feel bigger, and it also gave me opportunities to sneak lights in above or neg, whereas say a 69, a spherical, you would see more roof. It'd been a lot more ceiling in this show, a lot more white ceiling, which is like would have been ugly as hell. And I also couldn't have controlled the light in there as much either. So the anamorphics, it worked for so many reasons. And not just aesthetically, I love that look, but it wasn't totally just the look we wanted.
Yeah, it was practical too.
It's very practical. Yeah,
it's weird to find situations where anamorphic arts are
practical.
More practical than spherical.
And I love how anamorphic lenses are slowly getting a little smaller. You know, like I mean, we use Panavision T and G glass, which is like my favorite. T's specifically, they're both amazing, but T is there's something special about that. Yes. But they're giant and they're heavy. So they're starting to create new lenses that are just smaller. So because we really want those lenses on drones and we want them in the air, but we can't put them on.
No,
so now
crazy.
How do we get them smaller and weigh 1/10 of the weight?
I would like to talk about how you get like difference in the obviously the same set, obviously the same location, but in this part of the episode, things start getting a little grimmer and like a little more of a thriller kind of vibe.
Open up. Is anyone there?
Riley, thank God.
What the hell is going on? Some crazy crossbow freak chased me up the deck.
Yeah, so this is episode 106.
Yeah.
So right away when we were given this script, it was our favorite. We're like, oh, this is going to be so much fun.
Yeah, this is honestly my favorite too.
Yeah, I think it's a lot of people's favorite episode because it is like it's a theme episode. It's a horror movie. Half of it's a horror movie. And then you find out it's like the payoff is it was just a joke the whole time. but that allowed us to treat it like a horror movie from frame one. You know, it's all handheld this episode, which we only did in this one episode.
Yeah.
We didn't do any handheld. So this whole thing is handheld, which is very fun and freeing, actually, because we, you know, in a cabin you have a giant camera, you want to move it left to right. It takes a lot to move that. You can't put it on a slider. You can put on a slider, but it's got to be a big slider, and that needs support, and it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. But when we started doing 106, we realized how freeing that handheld was. It was just so much fun, and the operators had a lot of fun and whipping around, and so with the choice was made early on. Like, as soon as we read that script, we all agreed that let's just make this a completely different style.
Yeah.
And that means, you know, the lighting was harsher, the color grade was harsher, like just like a bit less saturation.
You have way more haze and more.
Yeah, more haze. Yeah. And the crazy part was we shot this in five days, this episode. And it rained for 4.5 of those days, and it's perfect because the first thing of the first scene description it says rainy day, and so we're like, oh man, we're gonna have to do rain towers, and it's just gonna be so much time, and I don't know how you do rain towers in this location. It would have been crazy. Anyway, so it just rained the whole time, so it just looks extra perfect. I got really lucky, and we'd step outside, and it's like raining, and it's perfect for the episode.
Yeah.
So I think part of it was luck that it looks this good. This is my favorite looking episode too. I've gone back and forth between this and like some other really pretty episodes where it's just a lot of lake and a lot of trees, and I love those episodes too.
Yeah.
But I like this one because it's so far away from the rest, the tone of the show.
Yeah.
And it's just a lot of fun. And all these actors are just, I love that they're hamming it up so much. Like Travis, who's a friend of mine now too. He's a great dude. He plays Riley. He's this guy here. And he's just so funny in this episode. He's just way over the top.
Yeah.
But then you find out, you know, he's faking it.
Yeah.
It's a joke. So it's perfect. It's a perfect performance because he's just so wild in it. He's like screaming. He gets shot in the leg, and it's like so funny. Anyway, he's great.
That's awesome. So the whole time you were on sticks before this episode?
Or? Yeah, everything for the lake is shot locked. Like locked or movement. A lot of times we're trying to block it in a way that we can play it in one master if we wanted to. So the whole point of the whole style that Paul and I discussed, like, you know, before we started shooting season one, was very traditional. So we wanted it to be like very linear movement, very deliberate movement, very static framed shots where the actors move in the shot rather than the camera finding the actors.
For sure.
So Which again, anamorphic lent itself very well to that, because then you can all, again, like, you can put four or five actors in a shot and then get them to move to camera, and maybe we'll do a linear dolly left to right, and then they can move right to left, and then we can, you know, it just the blocking was more so what we were trying to achieve, like very, very classic blocking, classic camera movement, which again, why 106 is so fun, because it's the exact opposite of that, right?
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's awesome. That's awesome. I'd love to talk about your exterior nights here, like the boathouse. That's a big one. That's one of the big sets. Yeah.
Yeah. I remember my gaffer came to me and said, after this, he's like, I think we have 47 lights playing right now, or some crazy shit. Because this is a set. So this is, I mean, they built this exterior boathouse. Okay. So we had to light the foreground, the trees, we had to light inside this fake thing. We had to light, when we do the reverse, you'll see there's like boats in the water. We had to light those water. We had to light that water. We had, you know, so what it was, that one, that's the biggest setup probably right here.
Yeah.
Because see the nice light on the top of the roof. Yeah, for sure. I love the way that looks.
How'd you get that up there?
It was on a lift. I think it's a 360, the Area 360. We made it a conscious decision to make it kind of a little bit cartoony blue the whole time.
Yeah, like cyan-y.
Yeah, like I like that. I don't do it all the time, but I do like it for this because it's a little, it's not quite reality, this show. It's like in a different world. And so I think that I went a little further than I usually would with the color of the moonlight, but that was a 360 coming from the back. So we had one on a lift behind coming that way. And then we had another one probably behind that was just giving some ambient fill that we'd soften up a little bit.
Right.
And then I just would, off camera, I would just fill in some faces and that kind of stuff. But even those lights, you know, like we have to power those.
Those little ones.
Out of focus lights. Yeah. There's so many lights in this. and there's Titans, like underneath that awning, there's a bunch of Titans that is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because see the red in the boathouse there, the whole thing is just a bunch of hidden Titans under the awning. And then we just would dim them up and down. That's the best thing about like all these, the LED stuff is that it makes things so much faster. So in this situation, we're using 40 lights. There's 30 of them that are powered on an iPad.
Yeah.
So you can just, you know, you can go up and down, you can change the color if you want, if it's too blue or too cyan or too bright. It just speeds it up a lot. So you can do a giant setup like this with a lot less time because of that.
Yeah.
I mean, it still takes time to set it all up.
For sure.
But the execution of it, if something needs to change, it's so much less work now to like change. You don't have to go up and gel it. You don't have to go, you know.
Yeah, you don't need a lamp up to it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
That's crazy. And this one's beautiful too. I mean, I don't know if this guy is.
It's that's fake. That's sky replacement. Yeah, yeah.
But I mean, the forest house.
Yeah,
lit.
Thanks, man.
It's really cool.
Yeah, I like this one. And this was probably, and I let the fire do a lot of the work. I filled in their faces with like a little probably S30, I'm guessing, or a Titan.
Right. I mean, because you can absolutely see like the heat waves coming.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, yeah. So which I love.
And, it is real fire.
The thing about fire too is it gets a little too flickery. Like it's a little distracting sometimes. So you have to fill them in. I find, at least for my own taste. Mm-hmm. Fill in faces again, and especially a scenes like this where there's comedy, and if I just let the fire do all the work, it would just be a little bit distracting because it's just very up and down. It goes from like, you know, it's like a 6-7 stop difference of the way it flickers.
For sure. What would you use for filling them up?
So as either S30 on the fire effect, and I probably have multiple ones because I love, because if you look at fire, if you see how fire works. It never goes quite black, and so it has a lot of peaks and valleys, mm-hmm. But it's all happening at the same time. So there's a really high highlights, but at the same time there's some really low.
Yeah, and then it changes position.
Changes position.
So the shadows are moving around.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. The shadows are really the giveaway. So I used to do, and I still do this. I just did it on one of the last episodes of season two. But a big wall of, you know, like six 650s or 1Ks or something, and then put those on flicker generators.
Oh, wow.
And so they're all doing some go from like 100 to 50, some go from 10 to 30, like percent, I mean, like the intensity of the light, I mean. And but so they're all doing completely different things. Yeah. And all the time they're changing, you know? So that to me looks the most real when you can do it. And then you also have to gel them if they're tungsten lights, just to make them that warm. But the fire effects on the Aries, they're not perfect. No offense, Aries. Please still send me a t-shirt. But they're getting better. The new updates have been a little bit better, but the Titans are a little pretty good. Like if you get a bunch of them in a row, you'll start to feel that flicker effect. For sure. But I still think the best, my favorite is still tungsten sources on flicker generators. Still, and a bunch of them. If you had a big fire, this is a tiny fire, so you only need a couple lights. But if you have a giant fire, you can do a wall of them, and it looks pretty cool.
That'd be amazing to do.
Yeah. And then, I think they did it in 1917.
Yeah. Roger Deakins.
He did a huge wall of light.
And then he was throwing lights on cables.
Yeah.
Pretending them to be flares and stuff.
And it looks so good. Oh, that's my God. Crazy. But that setup probably took 2 weeks.
For sure.
To set that up.
For sure. And now I want to talk about your exterior days and how you manage them. What's your approach to them?
So this stuff is all pretty natural. I mean, because we're on boats. This wasn't a tough day, but it was just this specific location we had to boat into. So it took a 20-minute boat ride, and it's basically an island that we're on. And so we have a camera on a jib that's attached to a boat, and then we did almost all the coverage from that, other than there's some land stuff of the two leads up on some rocks that they're about to jump in the water, and we did some of that on sticks, but all of this water stuff, so
all of this is from a boat. I mean,
yeah, all this stuff is on a boat, so the camera's crazy. On a boat for this stuff. So this stuff, I mean, this isn't totally the best exterior one, because I didn't really get to do much, because it was for this stuff specifically, I would say we went there and spent a lot of some time there to watch the light and which time is best to shoot at. And then we'd also just in our scouting, we'd take note of, okay, the sun's gonna be there and at this time and this in there at this time.
Where's your natural contrast going?
Yeah, exactly. So this is the best time to shoot this. I think the sun was a little bit behind them, and so you still have a nice soft fill on their face, but it looks like there's like a backlight and all that. Yeah, that light dapplage in the background.
You have a nice fall off too.
Yeah, exactly.
Their faces and stuff.
Yeah, so in this situation, I can't do much, but you just plan accordingly. You really push hard to shoot at the right times of day. Yeah. I'm always just do you want this to look the best, or is it a practical thing where we need to shoot it here because we only have a certain amount of time, or it needs a schedule a certain way?
For sure.
But to me, I'm always pushing as much as I can. Let's just please shoot this beautiful scene at a beautiful
at this time.
This is great, because this is the end of
episode one. I think.
Episode one, and so we wanted this to look awesome. So this is at the end of the day, actually.
Mm-hmm.
So we, with the assistant director of season one, we made sure that we would always shoot this location outside the exteriors of this the murder cabin. It's called is where they're staying. Would always be end of day, because the sun was always here and we could always look out into the water. We could always, and then I can actually soften the light coming in on them, as you can see on Madison.
Yeah, what have you got there?
That would probably be either a quarter silk, which I love, but it was pretty harsh sun, so probably a quarter grid cloth, I think.
Okay.
Because sometimes silk works, but if it's too harsh, and it was pretty harsh, but she's got great skin. She's easy to light, in all honesty. She's and Jordan too, they're both great skin, but most likely either quarter grid or quarter silk. I can't remember which one, but most likely quarter grid, because it is direct on them,
right?
But as you can see, it falls off on her really, really nicely. That's just planning with the assistant director. It's a big part of my job, is planning the time of day, especially this show, because it's such an exterior day show.
For sure.
When best to shoot those scenes, and also choosing what scenes what scenes you should prioritize for good lighting, because this is a scene where they kind of come, they talk to each other about some real stuff, and there's another scene actually that later on that's in the morning, and they talk about some real stuff. So all those things that the heart moments, I really wanted to make sure that we shot them at the right time. So I basically went down a list of here are my top 10 scenes I really, really want to shoot at perfect magic hour. I mean, and the director also, the directors would also be on board for that. Like either it was their idea, or I'd bring it up. And then just working with the assistant directors to make sure that this specific scene has to be at a good time. There's just no choice. And sometimes, again, like practicality wise, you need to shoot because you're running out of time, or the actor can only be available at a certain time of that day, and so the sun's overhead, and you just got to deal with that too. But when the emotion matters in the scene, I fight pretty hard to shoot at the right times of day. And it's just easier to control too when the sun's lower. It's gonna look nicer on every level.
For sure.
Softer.
For sure.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So if you don't mind, we can talk about maybe Ashgrove.
Sure.
Next project.
Let's do it.
That's a film for people that don't know, Ashgrove is a film by Jeremy Lalonde, starring Amanda Bruegel and Jonas Czernik. And it's a movie that relies heavily on improvisation. Right?
Yeah.
So as a DP.
It's literally there's not much more different. Like you couldn't have two projects that are more different from my
point of view. Yeah, it's crazy.
From my point of view.
Like the whole approach to filmmaking is way different than
completely.
Yeah.
Completely. Oh, the you got some clips?
Yeah, I got a bunch of clips of Jeremy. Thank you, Jeremy.
Sweet.
That was super nice.
I'm not gonna do any more passive aggressive shitty things for your acknowledgement or attention. That is my promise to you for the weekend, okay? Well, hopefully forever, but definitely for the weekend.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Well, then if you're doing that, I am going to be present. The whole time, here.
Yeah, it'd be great.
This is the one we were talking about earlier about me challenging myself to use as little lighting as possible.
Yeah.
So right now, I think there is a light in this scene, but it's just out of frame, just shooting probably onto Amanda, it looks like, and softened up. And that's the only light we used. And I probably was nagging the other window that's behind camera right now. Like, so I just would nag that. And I would always just try to light from one source, one side. And then if I could, maybe I might have softened it even more for these shots, just a little bit, like out of frame. I might have tried to sneak in a little frame of, opal or something. But really, it's probably one or two diffusion frames and like 1.2 or an 800 Joker or something. I can't remember exactly what light we had.
I guess it comes down to time of day too.
No, this one we didn't. This specific location, in the story, the kitchen specifically, there was no good time to shoot in the kitchen. It was just always dark in there.
Yeah. So this is where you actually needed a light.
This is where I needed a light. Yeah. This is the one light that we had on the scene was with the three that we had for this movie. Three
what
lights
light
that we had.
Did you bring with you?
I think it was a 1.2 PAR. Potentially 800 Joker. I can't remember which one we had. I think it was a PAR though, because I just like PAR because you can change the lenses and that gives me more versatility too.
Yeah.
We had a Titan kit. We went super low key and I had an 1S60, which is like the big purchase. Like that was like the one light that was like expensive. It's expensive.
Yeah.
And that's it. So I had a couple LEDs and one hard source essentially. Yeah. And then just some like and shaping stuff like floppies and flags and softening frames and that kind of stuff. But three completely different lights, but that's kind of on by design.
Yeah.
In case I needed a hard light, in case I needed something soft to fill it in, in case I needed to bring up the background, I could just hide one of those tubes behind a couch or something that's it.
And when it comes to the performance, because I mean they're improvising the scene.
Yeah.
Like there's no dialogue written. There's just like the characters have their objectives and you have to like...
Oh, you can see the frame there. Look at that. Hey,
you can?
Frame. Oh, there it is. I mean, I don't think anyone would know but me, but now you know.
So that little line is frame?
Oh, yeah.
It doesn't look like...
Don't tell anyone.
yeah, you can't tell.
Yeah, that's right. Well, that probably happened because it is all improvised. And I was operating for this movie as well. And I don't for the lake. I have operators for the lake. So I have like a, for the lake, I have a headset and I'm telling the operators what to do. And they're obviously they're doing their own thing too, because they're pros. But for the Ashgrove, it was all improvised acting. So I'm also improvised operating.
Yeah.
So I'm sure that moment felt like I needed to get closer, and I probably lit it for that wide that we saw at the, off the top, and you don't see the light. Then I was like, oh shit, this feels like. So I would walk in, and I'm sure that's why. I'm sure by the end of that shot, I was like, oh fuck, I can see the light. but that's what's kind of like, that was kind of so freeing about it, was that I would watch the blocking with the actors. Jeremy would go talk to the actors, and I would just sort of try to figure out what the coverage needs to be. And Jeremy, obviously, we both try to figure out what the coverage would be. But it would just be, the first take was always like, I'm sure the first take was used in some of these, on some of these scenes, but a lot of it was like, we would just know that it might be a total throwaway.
Yeah, like play around with it and experiment.
Yeah, exactly.
See what happens.
Yeah, and it was all handheld, so it was handheld, and which allowed me to do a close up in the same shot as a wide shot.
Yeah,
you know, it allowed me to follow the action a lot more. This really, I leaned on my documentary style.
Yeah.
My training in documentaries, because it was a lot of follow the puck stuff. Like the whole thing is that, really.
You know, it shows. It's
yeah.
It's really
like
amazing.
We would still do stuff like we would if the scene really worked and we got it. We're like, okay, we have a little bit of time. Let's just get a couple, like a close up.
Yeah,
I'll just get a couple.
A little bit more coverage.
Change the lens, just a little more coverage. And Jeremy's really great at knowing that he doesn't need that stuff. But if he felt like, oh, that's such an emotional scene, let's just get, like, we have a little bit of time, let's just get that tight shot of that. But then again, they had improvised the dialogue.
Yeah.
So then it was never quite the same. So to cut that together, I'm sure was not fun at all, you know?
Yeah, that's crazy.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I guess when you see something and you kind of want to do it again, you just went for it, like, in a different shot. That makes sense.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, because once they did it, you know, two or three times, they would kind of get the rhythm of the scene a bit more. But those first two, three, four takes were all kind of, you know, just completely freestyle. It was all just very freestyle. As a camera, actors, blocking, you know, the only thing I would say it was what we did very well was like, okay, so here's the window. And we want to shoot lengthwise, for example, of this room. So you are best here. You don't have to stay here, but here's your best light. Know that so you can work your way into it and out of it and back to it if you need to.
For sure.
Here's your best light. That's all I'm going to give them.
Not locking them up in one place, but like kind of
just
gravitating towards.
Yes, exactly, exactly. So then in the scene, like even for this one, I mean, this is easy. There's only one source here. So just stay looking, you know, stay three quarters to that or half, you know, it looks just like pretty sidey. But yeah, so that was the kind of the fun thing was like, even for the actors too, because they had a lot of freedom, but also they knew what I needed as well. So that to me is really crazy too, to be acting and say, here's the best places to be. And then seeing them actually improvise and get back to the best light was awesome to see that stuff. Because then it makes me look better, it makes them look. And I mean,
for
actors
sure.
love
looking
great. Yeah, who wouldn't?
Yeah, no, it's amazing. It's amazing. There's this dinner scene that I really like too.
I desperately want you guys to tell the story of your very first date.
I've heard enough about it. I don't know that we need to.
You need to hear the story. It's fun.
It wasn't a date.
It was, yeah.
It was a date.
It was a
kiss.
No. You leapt like Clark Kent into the crowd and suddenly started body surfing. It was just like hands on butts and boots and faces.
Hands on butts.
Oh, I mean, yeah. I mean, people are propelling you. They're passing you from one to the other.
Oh, I thought you meant your hands. Your hands were on.
No.
No,
it was like, yeah.
So you got pushed into kissing.
We got pushed into, physical contact.
I guess it was only one camera. But when they're improvising,
the camera,
you have different, spoiler alert, different timelines.
Yeah.
And like
yeah.
people doing the same things differently.
Yeah.
Once and again and again and again.
Yeah, so the story is like, to not give anything too away, but the story takes place, it is oddly enough, the idea was conceived of pre-pandemic, and it's kind of a pandemic movie, which is weird and super creepy that we shot it during a pandemic, like mid-pandemic. We locked ourselves in a farmhouse for 10 days and shot a movie.
It's crazy that you shot the whole thing in 10 days.
10 days, yeah. But that's the thing, like, again, not allowing myself to light. Like, this one, I definitely had a fill light coming from the side there. You can see it.
This one?
Yeah, like that's supposed to be the window light that you see in the wide shot. But there's nothing else. All that edge light is just from the window, you know, like, you know, I just would fill in, this to me was only, I would only fill in faces when I need to. And because you need to see, you know, like I struggle with sometimes, like, I need to see eyes because that's like the window into the soul, as lame as that sounds.
That's where the emotion.
Yeah. And you need to see people experiencing emotion, and you can only get that through the eyes. So if you can't see it, like, see how they always have a little bit of hit in their eyes. Yeah. They always have, you know, and actually I learned that kind of like pretty early on in my, I think, you know, I might've read something or I can't remember, but I've always do eye lights now, like very subtle ones. Like I don't want to fill, because sometimes you would do an eye light and it fills in all your too much. And like, oh shit, no, I just want like a little tiny, like a bulb on almost nothing. And I just want to see a little hit in their eyes, which is super important to me now too, just to get that just a little hit. But yeah, this. So anyway, so long story short, so there is multiple timelines here. So what we did was no one else in this scene, Amanda, who is the lead on the other side of the table. Yeah, Amanda there. Amanda Bruegel. She actually is the only one that doesn't know what's going on in this scene. So everyone else is improvising and kind of has an idea as to what the scene is and what they're trying to achieve, but her. So Jeremy would take, between takes, he would take the other actors aside and change their wants and tactics completely. So because there's different timelines, things are happening, in real time. Some sort of are recreations of a past event, sort of, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So they had to. So they were improvising based on completely different direction, and Amanda is reacting to them doing that, and so she was like. She's great in this scene because it's like she has no idea what the fuck's going on. That's how she should feel, because it is weird what's going on.
Yeah, no, this movie has an amazing twist, and it's crazy that Amanda was kept in the dark from that whole thing until the very last
day, that's right.
Pretty much.
Yeah, so Amanda, we all, there's only about three or four of us. I mean, the crew is only like 10 people. So, but three or four of us knew the ending of the movie, but we didn't know how it was going to play out. Amanda didn't know anything, really. She just knew she plays a scientist who's trying to save the world from this. But everything else was sort of kept from her, you know, and she didn't know some of the actors that showed up. She didn't know they're even in the movie, or if she did know they're in the movie, she didn't know when they were coming. So she would, there is a scene with the doctor. She's driving. So the scene is this emotional scene. Amanda's driving away from the property and the actress steps in front of her car and she had no idea. She actually thought the actress was showing up to like, hey, how are you doing, Amanda? I'm here. Yeah. Where do I go to get ready? No, but she was in the movie. The whole thing was
she was shot. Part of the
shot. She's part of the shot. Yeah.
That's crazy.
So it's pretty cool. Like, but Amanda was kept in the dark for most of it, which is, I'm sure was fun and frustrating for her all at once.
Yeah, no, I can't imagine.
Yeah.
And I'll just finally, to wrap up Ashgrove, there's just these scenes on the canoes that I really love.
Yeah, this gives me anxiety.
I want to know about that too.
Just paddle on the right. Paddle on the right.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
You want me to help? Are you trying to turn this perpendicular? What are you doing?
Now that I did the lake after this.
Right.
I've done tons of boat stuff, and I'm very equipped in what you need to shoot well on the water, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So this was, again, a no-budget movie. And so they put me in a canoe with a person in the front, person in the back.
To balance the weight.
Probably too much weight. And sure enough, at some point, the canoe tipped over and we lost a fucking camera.
Holy shit.
Into the water. Yeah, oh yeah, it made it. It was day two, I think. Oh my God. So this shot. So this shot right here, right after this, I literally tilt back up, not in the actual shot that they use, but specific shot, if you were to play this whole clip, is when it tips over. I think what happened was we all shifted weight at the exact same time. So we all went left we all, you know, like, because you're constantly doing this, and I think we all went like this, and it just went, it was literally, it took no, it was like up and we're in the water. It was that fast. It was just like over. And sure enough, yeah, anyways, so, but Sim Video, who provided the gear, you know, weren't happy, obviously. but shit happens, and we had good insurance, yada, yada,
that's
yada.
Great.
But we learned a lot, honestly. It was the original, no, it was, yeah, the original LF. So okay. The original one.
Okay.
So we got another one, thankfully.
But you managed to salvage the card.
The clip wasn't affected somehow. Like, wow. I mean, the clip, you can see it cuts.
Yeah.
But we didn't lose any of the media, which is insane.
That's crazy. The lens, what happened to the lens?
Done. It was completely done. So the good and bad thing. We shot this on the Atlas, and thankfully they're not the most, they're beautiful lenses. I'm going to use them a lot in the future, especially because the new ones they have are a little bit, they've perfected some of the imperfections,
yeah,
which are kind of beautiful too, the imperfections.
Yeah, the imperfections are great. I mean, you can see them in this movie. They give them a whole lot of texture to it.
And I like that they're a little softer, because I hate lenses that are too sharp, especially in HD. But so the lens, yeah, was an Atlas. Thankfully, that's a little less money than if a Panavision glass went into that. That lens has probably been around for 40 years and costs a shit ton more money to replace.
Shit.
You know, like, so thankfully, you know, again, sorry to Atlas for ruining one of their lenses and Sim for ruining one of their cameras. But, you know, stuff like that happens. And again, we, in prep, I was so... I was like, we should get a flat bottom boat to put the camera. Flat bottom. It's not going to tip. But in low budget filmmaking, you're always trying to cut corners, and they just had two canoes. So like, why don't we just throw it in a canoe? And that's, I was like, I knew.
Were you on
in
an
my
easy rig?
Gut,
or?
I was on an easy rig, yeah. Right. And I knew in my gut that it wasn't a good idea.
Yeah.
Getting into that canoe, I was like, oh, I don't know about this, man.
Hindsight 2020.
Yeah, exactly. But now that I've done the lake, which we did tons of boat rigs, and I just know. And especially because I learned how not to do it.
For sure.
I was like, I took that into the lake and being like, we will never dunk a fucking camera. Please. So we'll do everything we can to not do that.
Yeah, safety first.
And it's, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's experience. I mean, you learn from it.
Terrible,
you own your...
Terrible experience. I apologized, and we had some... It was, the crazy part about that was that we were so... Because it was day two or three, I can't remember what day, one of the two, because it was such a dramatic thing to happen, and I had never wrecked any piece of gear, even as a camera assistant, like I never dropped... I never dropped anything. I never broke a fucking filter.
Yeah.
So just to completely destroy a camera was like very not, it's like it was not on brand, I guess, for any camera operator, really. It just very rarely happens.
For sure.
But because it was so dramatic, it kind of bonded our crew, because we were kind of like, holy fuck, I can't believe that happened. Like, this is insane. And we felt sick, and we felt like it was, the movie was, it's over, you know, like, what the fuck, we can't keep, we can't, we just ruin, like, you know, thankfully, again, that Sim got us a camera that day, shipped up to where we were in Kitchener, we learned, it did bond us together in this weird, dramatic, you know, the intensity of the moment really sort of gave us pause to sort of look at ourselves and be like, oh, everything's not that bad.
Yeah.
And we bonded over the tragedy of losing the camera. It's really bizarre. It's hard to explain.
Yeah,
but after that day, we still got two scenes done. When the new camera came, we got two scenes. So we did still shot a bunch of stuff that day, and we lost a camera. So it was kind of like this moment of like, we still did this. Okay, we got to keep going. It was such a like a, we fucking still got some scenes, man.
The worst
and we just started,
could have happened, happened, and then
exactly, we still got stuff.
Stop us. Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, so even Jeremy will attest to that too. Like, it was such a bonding. And honestly, with the mood was good the whole time. Everyone's great on that set. But that really put us in over the top.
Yeah,
you know, it was like kind of like a great.
I hope to bring Jeremy onto the show one day.
Yeah, yeah,
talk about
yeah,
that
yeah.
too.
Oh, yeah, that'd
be amazing.
Just that 1 hour of that.
I mean, the whole movie is just a feat, like a whole thing. I think there's also a documentary, right? About
I don't sure if it's out yet or not, but
they made it.
Yeah. So the point of the whole, like, so they sold the rights to the movie, with the caveat that they would have a documentary as well. So if the movie turned out bad, which it could have, like it's all improvised, we didn't have the ending, you know, like we improvise actors that haven't really done much improvising. It could have not gone well. So it was being documented from day one of pre-production. So all the Zoom calls and all the meetings and all the me and Jeremy scouting the location, all of that stuff is just in case there's something interesting. That, I mean, and the camera going in the water is probably the most dramatic thing that happened. But in general, the process is it'd be cool to see how it. In my mind, I remember it as something, but it'll be interesting to see because in the moment it's one thing, but to see it from a
From
the outside, it'd be interesting to see. Yeah, like because the process was so I might not ever shoot anything like that style of process ever again. You know, it was that different.
Pretty awesome. It's good to have that documentary.
Yeah, I know.
Hopefully, it'll come out soon.
Yeah. I think it should be because the movie's coming out soon. So
yeah.
Awesome. Or it's out now.
It's out now. It's in the theaters. The premiere was on Friday, right?
Yeah.
But awesome, man. Thank you so much for being this. I would just like to wrap up with maybe you have any advice for filmmakers or cinematographers out there that want to do this out of a...
Yeah, I think I kind of said it earlier, but I always go back to two things. One, when you find people that you really connect with on an artistic level, keep them close. Because it's not going to happen often. And someone that you can trust creatively, keep those people close. And the second is, as a DP, don't have an ego as to projects when you're just starting out. Shoot everything and anything and everything, because there will always be something you learn from that that project, whether it be you get to rent a piece of gear or you get to work with a specific actor or you meet a director or the producer, there's always something you get from every project. So, you know, like when I was younger, I was a little choosy at times, I think, but maybe in a good way. But there was definitely projects I probably should have done and I regret, just because, you know, I find out later that the second PA on it's now like a big director. I'm like, oh, I could have just hung out with that person for a couple weeks or something. And it would have been, I could have got to know them and then maybe done their next project. So it's even that those relationships you build from every project is a big part of it. And I think just, you know, shoot anything and everything. And again, you'll learn. The only way to do what we do is to, like for directors, for anyone writing, is to just do it. You know, like you'll look back at your the work that you do now in 5 years and you'll hate all of it. But that should be the case. You should hate it.
Yeah, because you're getting better.
Yeah, because you're getting better. Exactly, yeah. And just always, for me personally, it's always like I try to reinvent the way I light stuff, because as soon as I feel like I'm dialing it in, I lose interest. I'm always trying to find new ways to light things, new lights to use, new techniques to make the light the way I want it to look, and just keep it fresh, because it's a technical job, and sometimes you get into going down a road where you can just do the same thing over and over again. Especially, I mean, I shoot a lot of comedy. I don't shoot all comedy, but there's a way a comedy is supposed to look, and the way that I shoot it different than other people, I'd like to think anyways. So, but there is still a comedy look, and I try my best to switch it up as far as like what I think a comedy, like reinterpret what a comedy is and reinterpret the visuals of a comedy and try to, and again, I have to pitch that to people and make sure that they are on the same page, because I can't just go to a set and do it. And they're like, what the fuck are you doing? Do that thing that they did, you know? So I think it's just always be reinventing yourself, take chances, and stick close to the people that you agree with artistically.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So, yeah.
And just to finish up, I'd like to finish up with this game of questions that I call Run and Gun.
Oh, shit.
Just a few questions that you need to answer whatever comes to mind first. And don't think about it too much.
Oh, God.
All right.
Okay.
If it wasn't cinematography, what other department would you do?
Like in film? Can I ask you? I have to just go quicker. We can start again.
In film, yeah.
Other department? The art department.
And if it wasn't film, what would you do?
Something in politics, probably. I just have a crazy political elbow. Is that what they say?
Well,
probably not. But yeah, I like politics a lot. Yeah.
Interesting. Light meter, false color, or eyeballing?
A little bit of everything.
Okay.
Yeah, a little bit of everything.
Cool.
Yeah, false color is the most expensive light meter on the planet. Light meters I use for ratios. And eyeballing, you kind of have to eyeball when you're moving so fast, especially in low budget and in TV world. You're moving so fast, you're kind of just like, yeah, probably fine. Let's shoot.
All right. Wide open or deep focus?
Depends on the project. I prefer, if I can, to be at, I usually like, I honestly like to shoot, it's weird, but I like to shoot around a 2.8 and a 4-ish at all times, because I find when you're wide open on most lenses, it doesn't look great.
Yeah,
it's a little soft and a little bit weird.
A little more towards the sweet spot of sharpness.
Yeah, the sweet spot, and that changes for every single lens. Yeah. So I think for me, it's depends on the lens I'm using, depends on the project, and depends on the when we test lenses. That's one of the things I test, is like, what does it look like at every stop? You know, it's sometimes there's a sweet spot. Sometimes those imperfections of wide open are kind of the most beautiful part of the lens. So yeah. Sometimes, if the scene requires it, let's do that. You know, so I kind of like to, I like to play in the sweet spot, but I also like to use the wide open as a tool, and use a deep focus as a tool. You know,
yeah, that's awesome. All right, so handheld or sticks?
I like, because everything was handheld for so long. There's a big chunk of time where every movie, every show, everything was fucking handheld. And that, as an operator, I'm just like sick of it. And it depends on the in The Lake, there's that one episode that requires handheld, and it works perfectly because it's like a horror movie and it should be whipping around and it creates energy. But I love classic film. I love like Spielberg and all those people that move the camera really classically. Yeah. And I think I'm always trying to either convince people that's how we should do it, or that's what I like. That's the aesthetic that I like. But again, if the story requires, like we did in episode 106 in season one, if it requires that energy or that tone shift, then I'll pop it on my shoulder and give it some energy. Cool. But I love a classic camera movement personally. You know?
All right. I mean, I guess all of these questions will be like, it depends, obviously, right?
Yeah. But yeah.
Whatever comes to mind first, wide angle or telephoto?
Telephoto.
Okay. Anamorphic or spherical?
Anamorphic.
Okay.
I think every DP would probably say that.
HMI or tungsten?
Tungsten.
Tungsten or LED? Yeah.
Tungsten, 100%.
Tungsten or the sun?
Tungsten.
All right.
Yeah.
Lighting people or lighting spaces?
People. Always people. Yeah.
All right. Film or digital?
I'm from a digital world. I shot... some of my first projects were on 35. I love film. I love the way it makes me feel and the way it looks. I don't think it's, personally, I don't think it's totally necessary anymore to shoot on film unless you're Spielberg, unless you have a shit ton of money. And I would love to shoot something on film, and I'm not opposed to that, and I feel comfortable in that world still. But digital just makes more sense.
Yeah.
Logistically, financially, you know, economically.
Right. Series or feature film?
You know what? I don't have a preference. I like the stories will, if there's a great story that needs to be serialized, awesome. If it can be told in 2 hours, awesome. It's kind of one of the, it doesn't matter to me. Yeah.
Nice. Do you have a favorite? Do you have a favorite gel?
Favorite gel? not really. I don't use a ton of color. I like warming things up for faces if need be, maybe. Or making it really blue. So like, I guess CTB or CTO would be the ones I use the most. But I don't use a ton of color. I think it was overused when like all the LED lights came out. So every movie has so much color for the last 3 years. You're like, Jesus fucking. And again, if the story requires you're in a club or, you know, if you're in a room where it's like the light sources have yellow shades, then the light should be yellow, right?
Yeah.
But in general, I kind of like to keep it, again, kind of classic in a way, as much as I can. I don't know. Yeah. Again, if the story dictates some weird colors, I'll
for sure
go for it.
Do you have a favorite diffusion?
That's a good question. I think every DP has their like secret tricks. Mine would be 129, full grid. and magic cloth, super heavy. You need bigger lights, and you know, again, more. You need more. Just more light to make those work properly. But I also like to. I like bouncing off of Muzz or So I'd say those. Those are my top three. Just fucking heavy diffusion. Yeah. I love soft light. Again, if it requires hard light in the background, I just don't think I don't love hard light on faces. So I'm always trying to get it extra, and especially with like chip, like the digital chips and everything, and lenses like Leicas or something. Maybe they're just so sharp that I don't want to see the imperfections. That's what I love about film, is that it sort of softens it naturally. So I'm always trying to do that. I'm always trying to make it look like the movies that were shot on film when I was a kid. That's my goal at all times, is to make it look like Spielberg or something. You know, like that visual quality is just really, it's like harder to achieve now because the chips and this how sharp the lenses are.
Do you have a favorite filter?
I love digital diffusion right now, and I've been using that a lot. I use Glimmer Glass for a long time. I stacked those on the newest season of The Lake. I stacked two of them together. That reminds me, I should need to talk to Tiffin about making a one filter. Because when you stack filters, you start to get weird, like haloing and weird shit.
Yeah.
So I learned something that I can't do that all the time. I'd say those two. Yeah, just softening filters, soft effects. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
And any directors that you'd love to work with?
Fuck, there's so many. That is so hard. I would have said Taika Waititi about 4 years ago. Now that he's like a Marvel guy, and I would still, I mean, if he called a fuck, he's still one of my favorite. When he makes movies, Jojo Rabbit or Boy or Hunt for the Wilder People, those are some of my favorite films of the last 10 years. That style of comedy meets heart, which is, he does very, very well, and unlike anybody else. I just don't think he's Colin, is what I'm saying. But if he did, I would be there in a second for sure.
That's awesome. All right, man.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Of course. Thanks for having me.